We just have 2 minutes more. Meanwhile, I'll just make an announcement. We are planning for TapCon 2021 this year. We are going to advance it a little earlier, and we are going to have the session from June 4th to 6th. And the official invite will be ready in a couple of days. And we will encourage everyone to register for the same and make the event a grand success. Last year, we had it online only, so similar platform. And similar session online. We have reputed speakers from all through the country, and it's going to be a very exciting session. So I request all of you to join hands and make this event a very grand success. Every year we have TapCon only in July, but now that this pandemic is there, and once lockdown is going to be over, we might have our UG and PG sessions. So we thought we will advance the TAPCON event a little earlier and have it earlier. And that is why it has been planned like that. And the official invite will be ready in a couple of days, and we will say, circulate it in groups. And I request all the HODs who are here and to encourage their faculty and postgraduates to join, because we have enough number of reputed speakers, and it's going to be very interesting sessions. Right? We are going to have a minimal registration fee also for the same, and we will be giving you the gateway whereby you can register. So registration form, everything will be circulated in a day or two. So with this announcement, I welcome you all for this interesting slide seminar session. Though the pandemic is on, I encourage, I'm very much overwhelmed to see the response from the audience and many presenters who joined us. So I welcome all of you for this session. And without wasting much of time, we will go for the presentation. So first case will be from JIPMER, two cases from JIPMER. So I invite Dr. Karuna to start off her presentation. Dr. Karuna?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can start. Go to slideshow mode, Dr. All the other devices should be muted. Only one device should be unmuted. Otherwise, there will be a lot of echo, right?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Karuna, final year JR from the Department of Pathology, JIPMER. And I want to begin this session by thanking Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry chapter of IAPM and Dr. Srinivas, the reporting pathologist of this case, in providing me this opportunity. So we'll begin with the case history. We have here a 10-year-old male who presented with abdominal pain and features of precocious puberty, as you can see here, facial hair, acne, and also he had increase in size of his penis and testicles. And examination-wise, the child was alert and active, and vitals were within normal limits. And per abdomen, there was a 9x6 cm hard mass in the right hypochondriac and lumbar region, and it did not move with respiration. This is the CT finding, and this is the lesion here. Here we have a well-defined mildly enhancing soft tissue density lesion, and it was there in the subhepatic region, measuring approximately 11x10x9 cm, and it also had central areas of calcification. Right adrenal was not visualized separately, and right kidney, it was pushed inframedially, but it was normal. This is the axial views showing the same lesion here, this and this. And radiology-wise, they had given a possibility of sympathetic ganglia tumor, ganglioneuroma more than neuroblastoma considering the age. And among other investigations, testosterone was markedly elevated. Other hormones were normal. So we received this entire mass in toto, and it was almost the same size, and weight was 430 grams. And after fixation, if you see, the outer surface was well encapsulated, and the cut surface was homogeneous and gray tan with tiny areas of necrosis. So coming to microscopy, so low power view, we can see a well encapsulated tumor, and we had sheets of cells with few dilated sinusoids here and there. And these cells were all polygonal with abundant granular eosinophilic cytoplasm. And nucleus, it was round and variably placed. In some it was central, and in some it was eccentric also. And nucleoli was conspicuous in some. Otherwise, chromatin was vesicular. And few areas also showed pleomorphism, and tumor giant cells were also seen. And very occasionally, nuclear pseudo-inclusions were seen. Other histopathological findings, mitosis was very low at around 1 per 50 hyperfield and focal tumor necrosis was seen. Otherwise, there were no atypical mitotic figures, no clear cells, no venous capsular or sinusoidal invasion. So the differential diagnosis which we had considered initially was lesions arising from adrenal, and among that with this morphology, adrenal adenoma, adrenocortical carcinoma, and pheochromocytoma. We also had a possibility of extra-adrenal paraganglioma. So if we didn't have this radiology per se and kidney was not visualized properly, then we should also consider other eosinophilic renal tumors like clear cell RCC, granular variant, papillary RCC type 2, thyroid-like follicular RCC, XP11 translocation RCC, FH deficient and SH deficient RCC, and chromophobe RCCs. And also renal oncocytomas, epithelioid angiomyolipoma, xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis. And we should remember one thing, that metastatic tumors are the most common carcinomas in adrenal. So metastatic HCC also should be considered. And rarely even malignant melanoma. So now let's have a look at the immunohistochemistry of this case. Inhibin was diffusely positive. Calretinin was focally positive. And Ki-67 labeling index was around 1%. And other IHC markers like synaptophysin, chromogranin, and SNRED were negative. Since chromogranin and SNRED were negative, we had ruled out pheochromocytoma. And we had given a diagnosis of oncocytic adrenal neoplasm of uncertain malignant potential. Now we'll have a look at how we'll categorize it as benign, uncertain malignant potential, and malignant. So under adrenal cortical neoplasms, we have adenomas and carcinomas. Coming to carcinomas, these are malignant epithelial tumors of adrenal cortical cells. And in adults, the incidence is 0.5 to 2 per 1 million population. In children, it is very rare, and incidence is 0.1 to 0.2 per 1 million population. It is common in all age groups, but frequently occurs in the 5th to 6th decade. As I already told, it's very rare in children. And both in children as well as adults, it has a female preponderance. It can also be a part of hereditary syndromes like Lynch syndrome, Menn syndrome, Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome, etc. So coming to clinical features, patients can either present with hormone excess or non-specific symptoms related to tumor growth or even incidental findings like incidentalomas. So among hormone excess, hypercortisolism is the most common presentation in almost some 80% of cases, followed by androgen excess and mineralocorticoid excess. So this is a gross of adrenocortical carcinoma. Usually these are well circumscribed and encapsulated also. And they have this yellow to tan color with extensive areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. And histology wise, we'll have solid broad trabeculae or large nests of eosinophilic cells. And we'll also have atypical mitotic figures, and like here and here, and pleomorphism also, like here. So variants are as such very rare, but among that, oncocytic variant is the most common. Other variants include myxoid and sarcomatoid. So coming to our case, oncocytic adrenal cortical neoplasm, it is very rare, and less than 200 cases have been reported till now, since the first case report in 1986, and most of them are non-functioning. But sometimes these can be associated with androgen excess and virilization. And this is how a gross of oncocytic adenoma will look like. It will have this dark tan to mahogany brown color. And if you compare this with other cortisol and aldosterone producing adenoma, it will not have this orangish or yellowish color, which is due to high lipid content. Here, since lipid is not there, it will have this darker color. And morphology of cortisol and aldosterone producing adenoma will have lipid rich clear cells. And additionally, in aldosterone producing adenoma, we'll have this eosinophilic scroll like inclusions within the cytoplasm. But as the name suggests, in the oncocytic adrenal neoplasm, we'll have cells with abundant granular eosinophilic cytoplasm. And occasionally, nuclear pseudo inclusions can also be seen. And these tumors are usually positive for vimentin, melanin, steroidogenic factor 1, inhibin, and calretinin. And they are variably positive for synaptophysin, but always negative for chromogranin. This is similar to other adrenal adenomas. So morphology is the only clue. IHC markers wise, it doesn't like it's not different from other adrenal adenomas. So how do we categorize it as benign or malignant? We usually use the Weiss criteria. This nuclear grade, mitosis, atypical mitotic figures, clear cells, diffuse architecture, tumor necrosis, venous invasion, capsular invasion, and sinusoidal invasion. Of this, more than or equal to 3 should be present to call it as malignant. And Fletcher also gives a modified Weiss criteria, though in WHO they have not given that. And according to that, they have removed nuclear grade, diffuse architecture, venous invasion, and sinusoidal invasion. But if you see, clear cells are an important feature of this Weiss criteria. But since oncocytic neoplasms as such will not have any clear cells, we have to use this Lin-Weiss Bisceglia criteria. And according to this, most of the criteria remain same, except instead of this, we will not have this 25% clear cells. And we additionally will have this size of more than 10 centimeter and or weight of more than 200 grams. So here, if one major criteria is there, it is categorized as malignant. And if any number of minor criteria are there, it is categorized as uncertain malignant potential. And since in our case, we had a size of more than 10 centimeter and weight of almost some 400 grams, we had reported it as oncocytic adrenal neoplasm of uncertain malignant potential. And we also have to remember the VNAK criteria for pediatric adrenal tumors. We should not use Weiss criteria for pediatric tumors, though in our case, since it was an oncocytic adrenal neoplasm, we had used the modified Weiss criteria. But we should not use the Weiss criteria for pediatric adrenal tumors. So this VNAK criteria is almost the same, except instead of tumor weight of 200 grams, here we have 400 grams. And instead of tumor size of 10 centimeter, we have 10.5 centimeter. Additionally, we have this extension into periadrenal soft tissues and or adjacent organs, invasion into vena cava, and mitotic count, instead of 5 per 50 hyperfield, we have 15 per 20 hyperfield. And when it is less than 2, it is adenoma. When it is 3, it is indeterminate. And when it is more than or equal to 4, it is carcinoma. So these are some other case reports, which were also like reported by our consultant only, same oncocytic variant of adrenocortical carcinoma. So currently the patient is doing well and the testosterone level had fallen from 846 nanogram per deciliter to 137 nanogram per deciliter after surgical resection. Since we had reported it as uncertain malignant potential, not as carcinoma, they have not given any chemotherapy. Patient is doing well right now. Thank you.
Yeah, that is very nice case, Dr. Karuna. Was any questions from audience?
Padma,
yes,
am I audible?
Yes, yeah. Ma'am, you are audible.
Yeah, I just wanted to know whether they have done a karyotyping for this person.
No, ma'am, they have not done a karyotyping for this case.
Why don't you think it is warranted?
It can be like when we consider any of these congenital adrenal hyperplasias and all that. But as such, the sex hormone producing adenomas are not common in these cases. They usually don't present as a part of any congenital syndromes.
Yeah, multiple endocrine neoplasia syndrome. Is there any other any other coexisting abnormality in the endocrine organs? No.
No, like that's what ma'am. Patient had presented with features of precocious puberty.
Yeah, I know you showed me that. Yeah, but then yes, you said otherwise, the mitotic rate you said was very low, right? One.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Okay, so then what is the criteria for calling it indeterminate, or is it only because
of the size?
Only
because of the size. Only because of the size and weight.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Srinivas, you want to talk anything? You want to tell anything?
No, madam. Okay. Is it audible, madam?
Yeah, you are audible.
So our pediatric surgeons totally investigated this case. There is no other endocrinal abnormality apart from this adrenals, madam. And okay. This patient, actually, we reported in last year. And patient is under regular follow-up from last 1 year. And even the recent follow-up also, he is doing quite well, madam. Recent follow-up, last 1 month.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Karuna. Dr. Nadia, you can start up.
Yeah. Very good afternoon to everyone who's present here. Again, I would like to start by thanking the Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry chapter of IAPM and also Dr. Srinivas for giving me the opportunity to present here. So let's get started. The clinical history was the patient came with history of road traffic accident. So he had come for road traffic accident and he was being evaluated for blunt trauma. He was a 53-year-old male, not a known case of diabetes or hypertension. So they did a CCT abdomen, which revealed a 4 centimeter defect in the anterior wall of the abdomen with a herniation of ascending colon and hepatic flexure. So that was because of the road traffic accident. But there was something else as well that the CCT revealed. It also revealed that there was a 2.7 by 1.9 centimeter well-defined heterogeneously enhancing lesion in the medial limb of the right adrenal gland, suggestive of the adrenal incidentaloma. Patient had no symptoms or no complaints or nothing to do with the adrenal. He had come only with road traffic accident history and was getting evaluated because of a blunt trauma. So on CCT abdomen, as you can see where the arrow is pointed, there's a well-defined heterogeneously enhancing lesion, which was located in the medial limb of the right adrenal gland. It was fairly small, 2.7 by 1.9 centimeter. So these adrenal incidentalomas are defined as like masses in the adrenal, which, as the name suggests, are incidentally detected. Patient has no history or no clinical manifestation of the disease. So they had, in 2009, there was an American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists and Endocrine Surgeons who met, and they decided how to evaluate these incidentalomas further on the basis of CT scan, and next step is hormones. So first step on the basis of CT scan was whether the size was more than equal to 4 centimeter or less than 4 centimeter. So in our case, the size was less than 4 centimeter according to the radiologists. So the next step would be to do a hormone assessment. So we would do a plasma-free metanephrine as well as a dexamethasone suppression test to see exactly what hormones are getting synthesized by the adrenal. So in our case in JIPMA, we had, the patient was evaluated for its ACTH and cortisol level and a dexamethasone suppression test was done. ACTH level was 17.7, which was within normal limit, and cortisol was 7.54 microgram per deciliter, again within normal range. Even after 48 hours of dexamethasone suppression test, they had reduced, which it would not have happened if it was a primary or a secondary adrenal cortical tumor. And if you see, the plasma-free metanephrine level was also normal, 46. Normal should be 12 to 60 picogram per milliliter. So this was basically a non-functioning adrenal mass, just silently sitting in the patient's right adrenal gland. So next step, what we did here was, we conducted a 1311 MIBG scan in the nuclear medicine department. They reported that there was a focus of abnormal increased tracer uptake in the right adrenal region, which corresponded to the mass seen in the CT images. Now, what is interesting to note is that MIBG is an analog of noradrenaline, and it gets selectively uptaken by the chromaffin cells in the adrenal and non-adrenal locations, that is basically paraganglioma locations. So here, we can assume that the MIBG is being uptaken by the chromaffin cells, and so which indicates that it's probably a pheochromocytoma. This was from the nuclear medicine department. Fine. So the patient underwent a robot-assisted right adrenalectomy with the ventral hernia repair. Intraoperatively, a 4 by 3 centimeter right adrenal mass was noted. There was no obvious infiltration to the surrounding structure. This is important because it's only there's an invasion or it's metastasis, which we call it malignant. Otherwise, it's going to be an indolent or a benign. He did have a few episodes of hypertension intraoperatively, which was controlled, but he did not have anything preoperatively like we discussed. And even his post-operative course was uneventful. Antihypertensive medication was discontinued and the patient remained normotensive. All right. So what we received was this gross specimen. It was, as per our measurement, 4 by 2.7 by 1.7 centimeter, and it weighed around 13.6 grams. The outer surface was capsule was intact. There was no breach. And the cut surface, as you can see in the diagram, there is a part of the normal adrenal gland here, which the adrenal cortex outlining the entirety of the specimen, which is canary yellow in color. And then there's the adrenal medulla, which is a little more brownish, expanding into a tumor, which was this 3.1 by 2.6 by 1.7 centimeter large. So this part is the tumor, if you can see my arrow, and then the yellow, canary yellow part outlining the whole gland is the adrenal cortex, and this part is the adrenal medulla. So this is the tumor which is arising from the adrenal medulla. All right, now we go to histopathology. On low power, you can see the three layers of the adrenal cortex. Again, on a little higher power, you can see the three layers of the adrenal cortex, which means that the adrenal cortex was more or less completely fine. There was nothing coming out. I mean, there was no tumor proliferation here. Now in this low power, you can see that the tumor is not arising from the adrenal cortex, which appears normal. There's a tumor which is arising from the adrenal medulla. It is and is arranged in a vague organoid pattern with prominent vasculature. Again, similarly, vague alveolar and organoid pattern and classical Zell-Balin pattern is also seen. And if you see closely, the tumor cells are moderate to markedly pleomorphic with abundant clear to amphiphilic cytoplasm, with many containing cytoplasmic hyaline globules. So these cytoplasmic hyaline globules were PAS sensitive, that is PAS positive, but it was diastase resistant. So that means they continued being there when treated with PAS with diastase. So like you would have already, guessed the diagnosis so far, it was pheochromocytoma. But what makes this case interesting was this. So in this picture, what you have to notice is there are two patterns. So the pattern recognition is why this case is interesting. So the first pattern, which is on the top of this picture, is the pheochromocytoma, like vague Zell-Balin and organoid alveolar pattern of the tumor cells. And there's another tumor, which is located right below it, seemingly merging with the pheochromocytoma. This tumor is more or less well-packed, moderately cellular, and is composed predominantly of spindle cells. Along with spindle cells on the right side of the picture, if you see, there are also these really large looking cells, which we will see further in the next slide. So again, this component showed stroma consisting of axons, Schwann cells, and mature ganglion cells. As you would have already guessed, these are the large ganglion cells. And background is the Schwannian stroma along with axons and Schwann cells. This is just the closer view. And again, this component, it's also had a few pheochromocytoma cells along with these cytoplasmic like globules. On immunohistochemistry, we first did a chromogranin. Chromogranin in the first picture is diffusely and very strongly positive in the pheochromocytoma tumor cells. Then look at the junction of the pheochromocytoma with this other tumor. There's a decreased density or intensity of this chromogranin A. And closely, if you see further, again, you'll see that there's a weak staining of this chromogranin A in this component. Then we did an S100 stain. So this S100 in the pheochromocytoma component stained only the sustentacular cells. And in this, it stained, it was weak positive in the ganglion cells in the second component. Then we did a neurofilament, which is very strongly positive in the axons of the second component, which you would have guessed by now is a ganglioneuroma. And the Ki-67 overall was very low. It was just around 2%. So our final diagnosis was a composite pheochromocytoma with ganglioneuroma component. Now, interestingly, this can be called a mixed adrenal medullary tumor, where there are two tumors arising from the adrenal medulla, or a mixed neuroendocrine and neural tumor. So this case was interesting overall because of the pattern recognition, because if in a hurry you only see the pheochromocytoma pattern and you remove your slide, then you'll miss out this important part of the diagnosis. So this composite pheochromocytoma refers to a pheochromocytoma that has a component resembling either a neuroblastoma, which you can see in the first image here, small round blue cells with neuropil, or a ganglioneuroblastoma with mature as well as immature neurons, neuropil, as well as Schwann cells. And then a ganglioneuroma in the bottom right component, which we also saw in our case, and a malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumor, which will have like very malignant looking like pleomorphic spindle cells. So these composite pheochromocytomas are very rare tumors. Till date, only around 20 cases have been reported. and they're most commonly in the retroperitoneum, urinary bladder, pancreas, phylum terminal, and posterior mediastinum. 23% of these are reportedly associated with neurofibroma 1. And there are other genes also which are responsible for this, like they can be RET gene as part of the MEN2A syndrome or the von Hippel-Lindau syndrome or the SDHB deficient genes. So why do they happen in the adrenal medulla and why is it called a mixed adrenal medullary tumor? It's because both the component of the adrenal medulla arise from the common neural crest cells. So these neural crest cells, they travel through the pre-aortic and the para-aortic sympathetic plexus, reach the adrenal medulla. And if the and then they form the neuroblasts as well as the pheochromoblasts. So if the tumor arises from the pheochromoblasts, it's a pheochromocytoma, simple. And if it arises from the neuroblasts, then it can take any of the three forms of the spectrum. That is the neuroblastoma, which is the most immature form, followed by ganglioneuroblastoma, and then the mature form, which is ganglioneuroma. So generally, composite pheochromocytoma obviously is a histological diagnosis because there's no way to pick it up on imaging or clinically. And they occur with equal frequency in both males and females and mostly middle-aged individuals, like 40 to 60 years. And approximately in 70% cases of all the composite pheochromocytomas that have been reported, the neural component is predominantly found to be ganglioneuroma. So ganglioneuroma, then followed by ganglioneuroblastoma, neuroblastoma, and lastly MPNST, which is really rare. The precise mechanism of this histopathological transformation is unclear. They've also proposed a theory that these tumors are like individually arising and they're together existing, or they could be just transforming into each other, or there could be a tumor-to-tumor metastasis where the same tumor is now, instead of going through to the chromaffin cell differentiation, it's going into the neural differentiation. Right. So the clinical course of this composite pheochromocytoma with ganglioneuroma has not been well documented because it's a rare tumor. And usually our assessment of the incidence of malignancy of these tumors is hampered because of this lack of follow-up. So therefore, this case was interesting and this case is important because we need to identify this composite pattern in pheochromocytoma so that we can help predict their biological behavior. So far, what my literature search revealed that if the ganglioneuroma part is there, then the entire the pheochromocytoma along with the ganglioneuroma both behave indolently. They're benign. They do not metastasize, and the patients completely recover after the tumor is removed. However, ganglioneuroblastoma, neuroblastoma, and especially MPNST, these are more of the malignant component. So they metastasize and they have a poorer prognosis. So that was it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanadia. It was really an interesting case. How was the patient doing after the surgery?
The patient is fine, ma'am. His hormones were never affected and he was never hypertensive. So it was just an incidental mass which was removed and the patient is better for it, but he does not know it.
So only during surgery he had hypertension, right? BP was fluctuating.
During, yes, ma'am. Intraoperative.
So the case is open for discussion now. So if there are any questions from the audience.
You said the follow-up is important in these cases, right?
Yes, ma'am. It is important.
Did you stress the importance of the patient coming back to you for a regular follow-up? Because we should know the 10 years from now, how he is behaving because of this composite picture, how he is behaving, whether he is likely to develop any, unlikely to develop any hypertension. But then, for a follow-up, did you stress that he should come back for the follow-up?
Yes, madam. Actually, this is a recent 2 months, February month's case, madam. This case is operated February, and mostly we are expecting this patient will come. Actually, because the patient was planned to operate in the last year only, year in the September, October, because of this COVID, he was operated February. Okay. Now, we are expecting he will in the follow-up, madam. February, this case we reported.
Okay. VMA was done in the urine?
VMA
also normal. VMA also normal, madam. This
okay.
Non-functioning only we can. Non-secretory component.
Yes, ma'am. Non-functioning.
Good. Very good case.
Thank you, Jitmal, for both the cases.
Thank you, madam. Just we kept both adrenals to Yeah,
yes.
That's what
one was contacts in Medulla. It was really good. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Srinivas.
Okay, thank you.
Now I call upon the next presenter, Stanley, right? Dr. Vijayalakshmi, okay. You can go to slideshow mode. Start from the slide number one. Slideshow mode. Yes. You can start up.
Good afternoon to one and all. This is Dr. Yes, ma'am. This is Dr. Vijayalakshmi, first year PG from the Department of Pathology, Stanley Medical College. Before starting, I would like to thank my respected HOD and Professor Arnalatha ma'am for giving me this opportunity, and the Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry chapter IAPM. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes, ma'am. Years old male presented to neurology department with the complaints of decreasing sensation both palms for 1 year.
Little slowly, Dr. Vijayalakshmi.
He is a known diabetic and hypertensive for the past 7 years, and he is on regular treatment. He is not a smoker or alcoholic. As a routine workup, he underwent ultrasound abdomen and instantly found a mass lesion of liver. Later, the MRI abdomen showed a well-defined heterogeneous lobulated lesion of size 7.5 x 7.3 x 8.8 cm in segments 6 and 8 of right lobe of liver, causing bulging under surface of liver. The impression given was Cori hemangioma of liver, and his liver function tests were all normal, and his serum alpha beta protein was 4.7, and it is also normal, and CA19-9 was normal. This is the MRI picture of him. The arrow mark showed the lesion in the right segment of the liver. And with the provisional clinical diagnosis of hemangioma of liver, patient was undertaken for the surgical procedure of right posterior segmentectomy liver of 6 and 8 segments, and the specimen was submitted for HPE. The GRAS findings, we received segmentectomy specimen of liver measuring 10 cross 5 cross 3 centimeter. The external surface showed a circumscribed brownish nodule, and the cut surface also shows a fairly circumscribed variegated mass measuring 4 cross 4 cross 3 centimeter with predominantly gelatin.
Sorry,
ma'am, I couldn't hear, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Your voice, there is a lag. Can you move to a place where you get a good connection?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
And have your microphone close to your mouth and then talk.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Continue.
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you are audible now.
Okay, ma'am. The GRAS findings, we received segmentectomy specimen of liver measuring 10 cross 5 cross 3 centimeter. The external surface shows a brownish nodule, and the cut surface shows a fairly circumscribed variegated mass measuring 4 cross 4 cross 3 centimeter with predominantly gelatinous areas and also multiple gray-white nodules and gray-brown areas. Actually, the tumor is located 1 centimeter from the resected margin, and grossly the capsule appears intact. This is the GRAS pictures. This is the external surface. And you can see this mass lesion and variegated appearance. This is the cut sections of the segment of liver. And here we can see the multiple gray-white nodules and the gelatinous areas and a gray-white nodule. And the microscopic findings, HPE images from the hemorrhagic areas showed lakes of blood in between the tumor cells, and also the dilated sinusoids in between the tumor cells. And here we can see the perithelioma pattern of tumor cells. And the HP images from the gray-white nodule shows micro and macro trabecular pattern of tumor cells and pseudoglandular pattern, perithelioma pattern. Here also the perithelioma pattern of tumor cells. It is the high power view of the malignant neoplasm shows a pleomorphic nuclei and prominent nucleoli. So the differential diagnosis given was hemangioma with the areas of hepatocellular carcinoma and hepatocellular carcinoma with pediosis. After putting the IHC studies, CD34 positive internal control, which is in the proliferating blood vessels, and CD34 negative in the areas of hemorrhage. This is a IHC study pictures, which shows a CD34 positive in the proliferating blood vessels and CD34 negative around the legs of bloods, which lack endothelial lining. So the final diagnosis given was well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma with pleiotic changes grade 1. After putting the IHC study of CD34, which is positive in the proliferative blood vessels and negative in the legs of blood lining and dilated sinusoids. So coming to the discussion, hepatocellular carcinoma with pleiotic changes mimics cavernous hemangioma. Pleosis hepatitis, it is a rare lesion on histology that shows blood-filled dilated sinusoids or cystic spaces lacking endothelial lining. Pleosis can be seen with hepatocellular carcinoma, hepatic adenoma, and mostly due to some medications like oral contraceptives, androgens, and anabolic steroids. Irregular enhancement of the peripheral part of the mass lesion on MRI study mimics cavernous hemangioma. So the differentiation between these two lesions on imaging is very difficult. As in our case, a mass lesion with features of hemangioma on MRI was later diagnosed to be a case of well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma with pleosis on histopathology. It is very difficult to differentiate between cavernous hemangioma and hepatocellular carcinoma with pleosis on imaging alone. So the liver biopsy is the gold standard. So differential diagnosis on histology for the hemorrhagic areas in case of malignancy liver, cavernous hemangioma, they will have dilated blood vessels lined by flattened endothelial cells which stain positive for CD34. And telangiectatic adenoma, which is characterized by less than 3 layers of cell thickness and also lacks nuclear atypia and no capillarization on CD34 staining. So the conclusion, what we seeing is believing. That is, hepatocellular carcinoma with pleiotic change is presented for its rarity and it is often misdiagnosed as hemangioma on imaging finding, which is a benign lesion. Though not of clinical significance, it has drawn attention as a morphological feature that modifies image findings of hepatocellular carcinoma and also alters the treatment modality. So in these cases, biopsy is the gold standard in doubtful hemangioma diagnosis on imaging. My references, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vijayalakshmi.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Case is open for discussion. I just want to know, hemangioma biopsies will be, they don't really do biopsy in case it's a contraindication.
In doubtful cases. Right. Yes, ma'am. We're not sure about the...
Yeah.
Okay. How do you connect the symptoms of both the palm getting some neurological problem with the liver?
Actually, he came for the neurological problems, ma'am. But as a routine workup only, we found that there was a space.
All that is agreed. But what is the reason for his neurological problem in both the palms?
He is a known diabetic and it might be some peripheral neuropathy.
You said he is not a known diabetic or hypertensive?
No, he is a known diabetic and hypertensive for the past
both.
7 years.
Okay.
Yes,
so that is a peripheral neuropathy.
Anyway,
I find Mukul the name here in the participants. Any comments from Mukul, the liver pathologist?
Hello, I am Dr. Tanga here. Am I audible?
Yeah.
What was the follow-up in this case? What about the serological tumor markers in this case? And what did your tumor board just agreed with? One, you have ruled out a hemangioma, I agree, CD34. What about the positive tumor markers in the liver for hepatocellular carcinoma? I think all those things have to be done before starting the next line of treatment, because hepatocellular carcinoma grade 1 needs follow-up. Hemangioma doesn't need. Yeah. Yes, but other markers, I think definitely your tumor board will insist on that. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, it's basic tumor markers like serum alpha beta protein and CA99 was normal only, ma'am.
But a good radiologist will be able to differentiate in the radiology itself between a hemangioma and a well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma, usually. Because hemangioma will be a, what was the radiology diagnosis in this case?
It's a Cori hemangioma of liver only, ma'am.
So then it is a must for you to put other tumor markers, IHC markers for hepatocellular carcinoma. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes, I also agree with Tanga, because
yes,
hepatocellular carcinoma also has to be proved by IHC.
Yes, madam. Yes, madam. Yes, ma'am.
Especially the last slide, which is highly neoplastic one. It was vascular and the slide was really terrible. It was the fourth slide which was projected in the slide, no? It is highly,
one,
yeah, the last slide. Yeah, projected in the thing.
This one, ma'am?
Yes.
These are the legs of blood in between the tumor cells, ma'am.
Yeah, vascular tumor with the HCC pattern. It was more on the higher grade, as everybody mentioned. We have to do the workup for HCC also.
Okay.
It was a good case and nice presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
The next doctor.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Did you observe anything?
Can we move on to the next case if there are no more questions? So you have to stop this. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Next case. Dr. Priyanka.
Oh, yes, ma'am. Is my screen
visible?
Yeah,
your screen is visible. Yeah, you can come, start up.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Priyanka, third year postgraduate from Meenakshi Medical College. I would like to thank my HOD and Professor Dr. Ishwari ma'am and IAPM Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry chapter for this opportunity. So we have a case report of 30-year-old female who presented with complaints of acute abdominal pain in the right iliac fossa to CSI hospital at Kanchipuram. The patient was initially evaluated for acute appendicitis based on the history and physical examination. The investigations done were USG abdomen, so which showed a well-defined hypoechogenic solid mass measuring 5 by 2 cm in the right iliac fossa, and other abdominal structures, including the appendix, was normal. And based on the this complex nature of this lesion, a computed tomographic scan was advised. So the CT abdomen showed a solid mass measuring 2.4 cm in the right abdomen, and thus the imaging findings have excluded the presence of appendicitis. So much of the clinical details were not available since this case was treated outside. The surgery performed was exploratory laparotomy. So in that, solid mass was found in the ileocecal mesentery, which appeared to be pushing the appendix, and there were other two masses found, one in the greater omentum and the other in the sigmoid mesentery. So their clinical suspicion was just all the three masses were surgically resected and sent to our college for histopathological examination. So we received the three resected masses. So the first one from the ileocecal mesentery, there were three gray brown to yellowish fibrofatty bits together measuring 6 into 4.2 into 2 cm. The cut surface was firm, yellow to gray white, And then second one was from the sigmoid mesentery. So this was a single brown to yellowish fibrofatty mass measuring 4 × 2 × 0.5 cm. The cut surface was again firm, yellow to gray white. And the third mass from the omentum. So this was again a yellowish fibrofatty mass measuring 8 × 5 × 0.6 cm. Cut surface was firm and gray white. So the microscopic features were the microscopy revealed fibrofatty tissue with spindle cells having oval to elongated vesicular nucleus and a prominent nucleoli. The surrounding stroma was infiltrated with neutrophils, lymphocytes, plasma cells, and proliferating small blood capillaries. And there were some focal areas showing myxoid stroma and hemorrhage. So this is the microscopic picture. Under 40x, we can see the admixture of loose vesicles of spindle cells with prominent inflammatory infiltrates. So the infiltrates were predominantly lymphoplasmacytic, so which were intermingled with the spindle cells. And this is the foci of myxoid areas. The microscopic findings gave an diagnosis which was suggestive of inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor. And to confirm this diagnosis, IHC markers were advised, such as vimentin, desmin, SMA, and CD117, and also to rule out GIST. So these were the IHC pictures. The c-kit showed a negative staining pattern, whereas desmin showed cytoplasmic positivity. Then SMA and vimentin again showed cytoplasmic positivity. And the IHC findings were c-kit or CD117 negative, desmin and SMA were positive, and vimentin was strongly positive. So along with the microscopic histopathological diagnosis, IHC led to the final diagnosis as inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor. So this tumor is an histologically distinctive lesion, which is a rare tumor primarily occurring in the viscera and soft tissue of children and young adults. So it is considered a tumor of borderline malignancy because of its tendency to recur locally and its ability to rarely metastasize. So originally, this tumor has its description in the occurrence in lungs, but due to its wide nature, it is present in every anatomic locations, and it is called under various names such as plasma cell granuloma, plasma cell pseudotumor, inflammatory myofibrohistiocytic proliferation, omental mesenteric myxoid hamartoma, inflammatory fibrosarcoma, inflammatory pseudotumor. So among all these names, the inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor is a preferred term, since inflammatory pseudotumor term has been applied to diverse entities. So clinically, the most common location is lungs. Apart from that, the extrapulmonary sites, the most common location is mesentery and omentum. And unusual sites are head and neck, brain, female genital tract, pancreas, heart, and other sites of GIT. And most commonly, it occurs in children, and the mean age is 10 years. And it has a slight female predilection. And the presenting symptoms will depend upon the site of the primary tumor involvement. So intra-abdominal tumor usually presents with abdominal pain and abdominal mass with increased abdominal girth. Occasionally, there can be signs and symptoms of GI obstruction. Systemic manifestations can be fever, night sweats, weight loss, and malaise. Laboratory findings shows increased elevated ESR, anemia, thrombocytosis, and hypergamma globulinemia. So all these systemic manifestations can disappear once the tumor is resected. So under the WHO classification for soft tissue tumors, the inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor lies under fibroblastic or myofibroblastic tumors. So grossly, these tumors are lobular, multinodular, or bosselated, and their cut surface is hard or rubbery, appears to be a white, a gray, or a tan, yellow, or red in color. Some may have a gritty sensation due to calcification. And the lesion is usually 2 to 20 centimeter in size. Histopathologically, based on the article Coffin et al., they have described three histological patterns, so which are often seen in combination within the same tumor. So the first pattern is myxoid or vascular pattern. So this pattern resembles nodular fasciitis. So it has loosely arranged plump spindle cells in an edematous or myxoid stroma and prominent vasculature. The inflammatory infiltrate contains more neutrophils and eosinophils than the plasma cells. And the second pattern is a compact spindle cell pattern. So this is characterized by cellular proliferation of spindle cells with a fascicular or a storiform architecture. So this pattern resembles a fibrous histiocytoma-like. And there are some foci which will typically show numerous plasma cells and lymphocytes admixed with spindle cells. And there can be discrete lymphoid follicles and plasma cell aggregates also. And the third pattern is fibromatosis-like pattern. So this pattern resembles a dense plate of collagen that is seen in desmoid tumor or a scar. So here it is relatively hypocellular with elongated rather than plump spindle cells in a densely collagenous background containing scattered lymphocytes, plasma cells, and eosinophils. So the spindle cells of this tumor are typically uniform in nature, predominantly myofibroblastic in appearance with palely eosinophilic cytoplasm, having plump ovoid to tapering vesicular nuclei with one or two small nucleoli. There may be a mild nuclear pleomorphism, but hyperchromasia is always absent. Some tumors have large histiocytoid cells, which resembles ganglion cells or Reed-Sternberg cells. The mitotic activity is generally very low, that is 0 to 2 mitosis per hyperfield, and atypical mitosis are very rare. So this is a histopathological image showing a typical appearance of spindle myofibroblastic cells containing ovoid nuclei with vesicular chromatin and palely eosinophilic cytoplasm. And there are some prominent plasma cells seen here. So this is the picture showing myxoid areas in IMT. And the special stains and immunohistochemistry. So these tumors always stain variably with the myoid markers. So based on the study by Mies and Ensinger, SMA is 90% will show positivity, whereas muscle-specific actin is 83% positive, and desmin is 9%. And focal areas show cytokeratin positivity about 77%. And according to study by Coffin, the SMA is 92% positive, and muscle-specific actin is 89% positive, and desmin is 69%, and cytokeratin is 36%. So there are also like high percentage of tumors associated with the ALK mutations. So some literatures have shown the range of 36 to 60% ALK positivity, but this marker lacks specificity and sensitivity since they doesn't correlate with the ALK mutations. So the confirmatory diagnosis will be molecular or cytogenetic analysis, so which will reveal the rearrangement of ALK locus at 2p23. So this can be seen in 50% of the cases. And this is a picture of ALK positivity. So here, the ALK with the RAN-BP2 fusion shows paranuclear membranous staining and some areas of dot-like cytoplasmic staining. So the differential diagnosis, it is based on the clinicopathologic setting, including the age, gender, tumor location, and number of lesions. So the DD for abdominal location of tumors, as like our case, the first DD is gastrointestinal stromal tumor, that is it should be considered due to their predominance among mesenchymal tumors of GI tract and mesentery. And here the cells are palely eosinophilic, and they have syncytial cytoplasm and cytological uniformity. In contrast with IMT, they have plump myofibroblasts scattered. In contrast, IMT has plump myofibroblasts, scattered ganglion-like cells and collagenous background. And although GIST has some inflammatory infiltrates, they are very patchy, and plasma cells are infrequent in GIST. And immunohistochemistry also helps in differentiating this because IMTs are always negative for c-kit. The second DD is inflammatory leiomyosarcoma. So this was considered because of its predilection for young adults and having a mixed storiform and fascicular spindle cell architecture and prominent inflammatory infiltrate, often with numerous foamy histiocytes. However, there might be the typical areas which shows the histological feature of leiomyosarcoma having spindle cells with cigar-shaped nuclei and having brightly eosinophilic cytoplasm. So this is usually identified in other focuses. So the third DD is desmoid fibromatosis. So this was considered because of its location in the mesentery. And histologically, it shows fasciitis-like features enhancing histological resemblance to IMT. However, in classic areas, the spindle cells of fibromatosis are usually arranged in long fascicles in contrast to the short fascicles or storiform patterns in the IMT. And here, the lymphocytic infiltrate may be present, but the plasma cells are infrequent. And furthermore, these tumors show aberrant nuclear positivity for beta-catenin. So the take-home message will be inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor is a distinctive neoplasm of intermediate biological potential. So it has a predilection for abdominopelvic region and lung in case of children and young adults. And the term inflammatory pseudotumor is better avoided because of its diverse application. And chromosomal translocations leading to ALK tyrosine kinase and overexpression of ALK protein can be detected in 50% of IMTs. And this is a diagnosis of exclusion in middle-aged and older adults and in somatic soft tissue. And the presence of more than mild nuclear atypia usually argues against the diagnosis. The mainstay of therapy is surgical resection. Chemotherapy and radiotherapy is indicated in case of recurrent or metastatic cases. And the recent advances is ALK-targeted inhibitor therapy, that is crizotinib, which has been found to be efficacious in treatment of aggressive tumors. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Priyanka, and thank you, Dr. Ishwari. The case is open for discussion.
Padma,
yes,
the
yeah.
Presenter need a real PAT for the excellent workup, and the differential diagnosis were very
well. Yeah, the presentation was really crystal clear.
And the slide also, the first slide itself was very accurate and diagnostic. And what are all the doubts we had, she has clearly clarified. Only two questions I wanted to ask her.
Yes,
this
ma'am.
This is a benign spectrum. What is the other spectrum you like to have in this patient? And then the presentation, is it so multiple nodule? That is the doubt I had.
Yes. Ma'am, actually, this case was treated outside. And we had only the oral history, which in CT, there was only one mass near the ileocecal mesentery. But while doing the laparotomy, they found other masses in the omentum and sigmoid mesentery also. Mm. And the other DD can be, it could be a low-grade myofibroblastic tumor, but there will be some cytologic atypia in that case. But our case doesn't have any nuclear atypia.
Yeah, this is the other end of the spectrum, I thought you
wanted. Other end?
It's the benign spectrum for, in our case. The other high-end spectrum, I thought you would have liked to know. That's all. Very well done.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
I'm Dr. Tanka. Am I audible? I have a question.
Yes, Dr. Tanka. Yeah, please.
Yeah. See, I want to know two things. What is the mitotic activity in this case? And what is the age? Age, I forgot.
Ma'am, age is 30. 30-year female it is.
30-year female, okay. See, why I am worried about this case is, yes, they said single mass in CT, and it, you received as multiple masses. Yes, so ma'am. In my experience, all CD117 negatives need not be called as, they are not just, no. If CD117 is negative, still in this scenario, when it is multiple nodules, we have to do other markers for just like DOG1, PDGFRA, like that. And mitosis, how much was the mitosis? How much was the mitosis?
Mitosis.
In this case, how many fields you counted? See, just we count mitosis for 50 fields, okay? So, and yeah, that's very important. And if you have a doubt, you have to do a K67. Just because it is CD117 negative, please go through the literature. It is not just as ruled out. And this is a young patient presented with multiple nodules. And sometimes if the, and somebody else has put it in the chat box, I think Dr. Krishna Kumar, ALK positivity, yeah. Negativity has, it has to be done. Okay, so if one marker is negative, finally do the other markers and rule out the gist. I'm not denying your diagnosis. I agree with your diagnosis, but we have to rule out, or when it comes for recurrence, we may not be able to help. Okay, so since already it is multiple nodules, DOG1 you can do, PDG, yes, for other markers are there, you rule out. Mitosis, mitosis is important. Doubtful, go and do a K67. Thank you for the comment that ALK positivity also has to be done. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, if there are no more questions, can we proceed to the next case from Salem Medical College?
அங்க கரெக்டா முடிஞ்சிட்டேன் நான் சொன்ன பாயிண்ட் ரெண்டும் அவ்வளவு அவளே பேஸ் பண்ணிட்டேன் சோ அதனால நான் வாயை திறக்கல தங்கான்னு இதுல இருக்கா
Thank you.
Yeah, Salem Medical College, Dr. Lal. Can you hear me, Dr. Lal?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I'm going to share the screen, ma'am.
Yeah. Go to slideshow mode and start off. Yes, your screen is visible. You can start.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Dalming Louis from Government Mohan Kumaramakalam Medical College, second year pathology resident. I'm going to present an interesting case from our department. We receive a 70 years female. I'm going to present a case from the 70 years female. I came with a history of abdominal distension with inability to pass stool and flatus. And with that, in the CT abdomen, they are finding a wall thickening in the iliocecal region with a proximal dilated small bowel loop. This that's suggestive of a subacute intestinal obstruction.
Little slowly. Can you be little slow in your presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
In that, we were doing the serum CA marker, serum CA, which is within normal limits. And then they are proceeding with the operation, in which in the intraoperative finding, they found the cecal growth with the subacute intestinal obstruction. In that we received a right hemicolectomy specimen measuring 72 centimeters in length, showing the colon, terminal ileum, and cecum with the attached appendix. In the cut, on the external surface shows gray-brown with the dilated bowel loop of the colon. And on the cut surface, we can see growth measuring 3 × 2 × 1 cm on the ileocecal region, which is firm, soft to firm, gray tan to yellow in color, arising from the submucosa. And then the adjacent intestinal mucosa shows normal rugosity, and the cut surface of the dilated bowel shows a thinned out mucosa, and then the appendix shows is within normal limits. This is the cut surface of the growth, showing two growth measuring, a larger measuring 3 × 2 × 1 cm, and the smaller measuring 1 × 1 cm, which is a gray tan to yellow in color, arising from the submucosa, grossly not involving the serosa. We are going to the microscopic pictures. Here we can see in the scanner view, the intestinal mucosa the intestinal mucosa and the under and with the underlying submucosa containing multiple nodules, and with the serous sac showing massive edematous and congested blood vessels, mainly due to the obstruction. This picture shows the tumor involving in the muscularis propria with a serosal nodule. This is the low power view. A low power view showing the intestinal mucosa with the underlying submucosa shows the neoplasm arranged in nest and cords and trabecule, showing a mono population of round cells. Here we can see in the high power view where we can see a uniform population of round cells having a moderate amount of pale eosinophilic cytoplasm with indistinct cell border with the round uniform nuclear membrane showing a stippled chromatin, which we can also say is like a salt and pepper appearance, which is separated by the thin fiber muscular thin fiber stroma. In this few areas of mitotic, occasional few mitotic figures are seen. No areas of necrosis is seen. This is a picture showing a lymphovascular invasion. With the diagnosis, with the previous pictures and then the findings, histological findings, we came into a conclusion of the well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumor of grade 1 from the ileocecal region and of the right hemicolectomy specimen. We will be discussing about the grading and the well-differentiated. Why we are mentioning the well-differentiated is because of there is no pleomorphic cells, they are of uniform cells. Which are uniform round cells. And then we put in a grade 1 because of the few mitotic figures, since occasional few mitotic figures of like 1 per 10 high power field is seen. Going to the discussion of the neuroendocrine tumor. In this neuroendocrine tumor in the GI tract, before it was called as a carcinoid tumor and that's replaced by the well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumor. This is we are referring to the low-grade malignant neoplasm of GI tract, mainly originating from the neuroendocrine cells, which is mainly present in the submucosa, like enterochromaffin cells. And then it occurs mainly in the adult, rarely seen in the children. And then the peak incidence is 6 to 7 decade of life. It is mainly, it can present any side of the organ, but in the intestine, it is commonly seen in the small intestine. Among the small intestine, ileum have the is the most common site, followed by jejunum, distal, and duodenum. Among these, 15 to 35% can also occur as a multiple node. As we had mentioned, that it can occur from any site. This can also occur in the pancreas, showing a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, and it can be classify according to the embryological development, like a foregut. Arising from the foregut, midgut, and hindgut, and if there is no origin site is known, it's called as unknown primary. The clinical features will be concentrating mostly on the intestine. If it is in a jejunal ileocerotonin producing neuroendocrine cells, the presenting symptoms mainly occur as a vague.
There was some technical issue. We'll just wait for 2 minutes, and if he is not able to come, then a present of some Vinayaka machine, be ready. I think he can continue his presentation later. Dr. Tamilchelvi, can you start off?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Let him do it last, like after finishing the. Thank you.
We
can start up.
Okay. Good afternoon, ma'am. I thank the organizer giving this opportunity for this to present in this forum. Just simple case only. 52-year-old female presented with the scalp swelling of 1 year duration. The excise mass was sent for histopathology examination. We received a single mass with a skin with the subcutaneous tissue, measuring about 2 into 1 into 1 centimeter. The cut surface and also the superficial external surface shows an elevated gray-white lesion, measuring about 1 into 0.5 centimeter. Cut surface also showed a gray-white to gray-black areas with the elevated nodule noted on a cross examination and also in the cut surface. This is a cut surface. Again, you can see that elevated nodule showing a gray-white area and also blackish areas. So this is a picture of scanner view, where you can see the section study shows skin epidermis, then dermis. Here also, again, you can nicely see that epidermis and dermis. Dermis shows the well-circumscribed lesion. You can find out that symmetrical lesion, well-circumscribed. There is no attachment with the epidermis. So again, the picture hyper view showing this with a different lobular pattern and also nesting pattern of this, and showing a peripheral palisading and retraction pocket, artificial retraction pocket. You can able to see that nicely. And also it appear like a lobules and nest. And here again, you can see in this picture hyper view showing the peripheral palisading. Again, you can see in this picture different multiple nodules within the dermis. Again, you can see here one or two Hahn cyst was noted in this section. Again, you can see islands of basaloid uniform tumors, basaloid cells with pigments are noted in that area. Again, showing picture with the nodules and papillary projection like with the separated by a fibrovascular basaloid cells proliferation with separated by a fibrocellular stroma. You can note it here. Okay. Again, the hyper view showing the pigments in the within the basaloid cells. Again, you can note that on cyst. So I summarize it. What I discussed so far is in the histopathology picture, well-circumscribed symmetrical lesion with no attachment to epidermis, basaloid epithelial cell proliferation, which is arranged in nodular architecture and also in nesting pattern with a peripheral palisading. Presence of occasional areas of cystic space is also noted. Focal area showing a pigmentation in the basaloid cells as well as in the stroma also noted. So with that diagnosis, we came to the diagnosis that pigmented trichoblastoma or trichoblastoma with the pigmentation, that otherwise known as a melanotrichoblastoma, which appears in the scalp, which is a rare slow growing tumor, which is the benign cutaneous tumor, which is derived from the follicular germinative cells of the hair. You can note it here. First, it is given by Headington, trichoblastoma, the word coined 1970 as a follicular differentiated neoplasm. In 1993, Ackerman et al., they further described this trichoblastoma to include all follicular germinative cell derived benign cutaneous tumors. The common sites will be the head and neck region, trunk and proximal extremities, and also genital areas. According to Ackerman classification, the trichoblastoma divided into 5 histological patterns: large nodular, including pigmented type; small nodular, cribriform, reciform, and retiform. Then in Leber's histopathology also, they included the other variants like Jain cells and also clear cells of the trichoblastoma. Trichoblastoma is this basaloid proliferation in which the tumor cells are arranged in cord pattern sheets and discrete clusters surrounded by a fibrous stroma. Pigmented trichoblastoma, they may contain the melanin deposition. Coming to the differential diagnosis here, why you want to present here for in this forum, this is a close differential diagnosis will be basal cell carcinoma. We have to differentiate from basal cell carcinoma, that is utmost important. And also the pigmented trichoblastoma is the rare one. So other differential diagnosis close to this will be the syringoma, desmoplastic trichoepithelioma, microcystic adnexal cell carcinoma. Coming to the difference between the basal cell carcinoma and the trichoblastoma, the age, if you take, this is BCC occurs in the older age, whereas relatively in younger age, they say is that trichoblastoma. Site, most commonly BCC occurs in the sun-exposed area, whereas it is not limited to sun-exposed area in a trichoblastoma. Location, mainly BCC located in the limited to dermis, but may be connected from the epidermis to dermis. Here, trichoblastoma, mostly it is located in the deep dermis and also it extends to the subcutaneous tissue. Peripheral palisading will be noted in basal cell carcinoma as well as in trichoblastoma. Artificial clefting will be noted in BCC, which is absent in trichoblastoma. Keratin cyst, it will be absent in basal cell carcinoma. It is usually noted in trichoblastoma. That is a trichoepithelioma, mostly it is noted classically, but trichoblastoma, there are one or two, few Hahn cysts may be there, the keratin cyst may be there. Stroma, most often in BCC, will be the mucinous stroma, whereas here in trichoblastoma, it is a fibroblastic stroma. follicular papillae will be there, which is not present in BCC, whereas here it is mostly it is noted present in trichoblastoma. Other histological features like nuclear atypia, mitotic activity, necrosis will be present in basal cell carcinoma, will not be present here, even though mitosis, may, very rarely they can find brisk mitosis. There, some literature they say is that mostly it is not noted in trichoblastoma. Then one more point here I want to insist is papillary mesenchymal body. That is nothing but condensation of the stromal cells which appear like a follicular cells like appearance will be there. In trichoblastoma, that is the most prominent point. I have searched in my section, I could not able to find out that, but it will be absent in basal cell carcinoma. Trichoblastoma, the immunohistochemical markers to put it that it is positive for stromal cluster differentiation CD10 as well as CD34 as well as for Flickin homologous like domain family A member 1, that is PHLDA1, which is the follicular stem cell marker. Whereas the basal cell carcinoma will not stain positivity for that, it will be mostly negative. Other differential diagnosis will be syringoma. Syringoma will have a striking ductal differentiation in the center of the tumor islands. And also the tumor islands often they will be comma shaped. That classical picture, we can note that. Here in desmoplastic trichoepithelioma also will be one of the close differential diagnosis where there will be presence of numerous Hahn cysts will be there. That rules out. And also there will be follicular differentiation will be there. Calcification will be noted. And presence of long epithelial strands will be there, which is not noted here. Microcystic adnexal cell carcinoma, which has a character feature, deep invasion, malignant features, extensive perineural invasion, and convincing ductal or glandular differentiation will be there. When you put immunohistochemical CK20, it will be negative. Whereas in desmoplastic trichoepithelioma, along with that, CK will be 20 will be applied, this will be positive. Remaining features already I discussed with you in the previous slide. So one thing you want to know that it is, even though it is a rare presentation of trichoblastoma, sometimes, you know, this trichoblastoma will be present with the multiple nodules. It may be associated with the genetic syndromes. That should be ruled out. Here, it is only a single nodule. There is no associated other tumor lesions in this patient. So it is not associated with the genetic syndrome. But one should rule out and examine family members to see, look into the genetic syndromes, mainly Brooks Fitzgerald disease and also Brooke-Fordyce syndrome. And also, it occurs as a sporadic and solitary tumor where there is a mutation occurs in the 9q22.3. Which is otherwise known as familial trichoblastomas. So I summarize it, take a message in my slide. It is summarized the findings, islands of uniform basalite cells, which is a well-circumscribed lesion, which showing that, and showing a peripheral palisading or branching pattern some areas, pigments are noted. Clubs in between the stromal cells, the stroma also shows a fibrocellular stroma, and some areas the Hahn cysts are noted, occasional Hahn cysts are noted. With this finding, I can able to say it is a melanotrichoblastoma or pigmented trichoblastoma, which occurs in the scalp, which is a rare tumor. The papillary mesenchymal body is typically prominent. They say that I'm not noticed that I'm went into the slides again, but maybe showing in a deeper section, I don't know, but I have to find out that, okay? So with that, thank you for giving this opportunity. End up with me.
Thank you, Dr. Tamichelvi. It was a nice case. The case is open for discussion. I'm sure Dr. Ariel Madam will have a lot of questions about it. Yeah. Madam is interested in dermatopathology.
No, no, as she was mentioning, I was also having an impression of this typical palisading, Hahn cysts, and then the stroma, all that we were thinking in the line of desmoplastic trichoepithelioma was in my mind, and pigmentation was there, and so with the presentation, I thought she has excluded everything. And then I thought it is a apt presentation. Good.
Given the extensive differential diagnosis and this tested.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Tamichelvi.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Let's go to Dr. Sangeeta. I think you should start from the first slide, Dr. Sangeeta. Dr. Sangeeta, you have to start from the beginning, I think. And there's a lot of voice interference.
Is it now clear, ma'am?
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Sangeeta, assistant professor from Vinayaka Mission Medical College. I'm presenting a common case, presenting here for its rare presentation. A 26-year-old male presented to medicine OPD with complaints of breathlessness on and off for the past 1 month, which got aggravated since the past 1 week. He had high-grade fever for 1 week. On arriving emergency room, he was tachypneic. His respiratory rate was 26 breaths per minute. Oxygen saturation 89% and saturation was maintaining with 2 liter oxygen. Then local examination, bilateral pitting pedal edema was present. So he has some pulmonary manifestations. And routine investigations were ordered. The CBC values are, his WBC count was elevated, 14,000. And that is a mild anemia. MCV indices were normal. So normocytic, normochromic anemia. Then platelets were within normal limits. And peripheral smear was ordered. In that peripheral smear picture, we were able to appreciate many sickle cells. So we gave the peripheral smear as normocytic normochromic anemia with many sickle cells, neutrophilic leukocytosis, and platelets were within normal limits. In view of many sickle cells, we ordered for hemoglobin electrophoresis. The sample was given for high-performance liquid chromatography at Hi-Tech Lab, Salem. And the report was turned out to be homozygous sickle cell disease. So I'm presenting here for its rare pulmonary complications. First definition, coming to the discussion, definition, sickle cell anemia is a common hereditary hemoglobinopathy caused by point mutation in beta globin that promotes the polymerization of deoxygenated hemoglobin, leading to red cell distortion, hemolytic anemia, microvascular obstruction, and ischemic tissue damage. It is caused by, you all know, it's caused by point mutation in 6th codon of beta globin that lead to replacement of glutamate residue with valine residue. Clinical features, there are three crises, vaso-occlusive crisis or pain crisis. Most commonly involved sites are bone, lung, liver, brain, spleen, penis. It manifests as hand-foot syndrome or tactilitis, acute chest syndrome. Second crisis, sequestration crisis. It usually occurs in children with intact spleens. Third, aplastic crisis seen due to parvovirus B19 infection. So, our case, a rare presentation as an acute chest syndrome. In sickle cell anemia, roughly around 10 to 20% of patients develop pulmonary artery hypertension. Here, the patient is presented with features mimicking early cardiogenic pulmonary edema with pulmonary artery hypertension. When investigated retrospectively, he is found to have sickle cell anemia, which was found to be the etiology for pulmonary artery hypertension. So, cardiopulmonary complications were the leading cause of death in these patients. These are my references. Thank you, ma'am.
So there are certain questions in the chat box, Dr. Sangeet. Shall I just read it out for you?
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
So they are asking for target cells present in the smear, and did you rule out sickle cell? HPLC was...
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. I will show you that HPLC result.
Yeah. The case is open for discussion. So if there are any questions, you can unmute and talk also.
This is a very interesting case where pathologists plays a very important role in the casualty to give a diagnosis. They picked up the sickle cells. Okay, so a simple peripheral smear will change the clinician's entire treatment, way of treatment and management. This is a very good case. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Only thing I wanted to add was, as KK said, a lot of target cells were there. So I thought it could be a sickle cell complication.
Yes,
yeah, we see quite often in our clinical practice, you know. But I don't know why that they have not picked up this. I don't know. Sickle cell combination was the one which we could see very blatantly in the peripheral smear. But your electrophoresis not showing that anyway.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
And what was the reti count like? Was the reti count done for this patient?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, there is no reti count was normal, ma'am. Around 1.2 something, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Any other new nucleated RBCs in the peripheral smear?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. That's why there is no evidence of active hemolysis, ma'am. No NRBCs, ma'am.
No, only thing is in context of sickle cell anemia, we expect the reticulocyte count to be slightly on the very high side. So only thing is whether he has an associated red cell suppression. That's only thing.
Yeah. And your hemoglobin electrophoresis, yes, it's homozygous, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
But what you had shown me was a very few sickle cells. In fact, the thalassemia, I mean, the target cells were more than the cell in the smear.
Okay,
anyway. But HPLC S window shows 65. A is only 4. So then we cannot think of a hemoglobin tile thing, madam.
Yeah.
That's a thing.
That's true. Okay.
That was a good case. Thank you. So Vinayaka Mission, both the cases were really good. Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
If Salem Medical College, if they are ready, Dr. Lal, if you are ready with your presentation, you can continue from where you left. Maybe the previous slide and then start off. You can stop presenting. Yeah, Dr. Lal, if you are ready, start from where you left. Maybe one slide prior and then start.
I'm really sorry for the inconvenience.
No issues. That happens every time. So no, don't worry. You can continue.
I will continue with the discussion. We'll start with the discussion. Like I have already said it.
You have to go to slideshow mode.
Okay.
Take your time, relax, and then talk. Not to worry. Yeah. Everybody were asking in the chat box whether Chi-67 was done for this case. Was it done?
Ma'am, due to this pandemic problem, we are waiting for the reagent to come, ma'am. We will be doing soon, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Yeah, you can continue presenting.
Okay, ma'am. going with the discussion, neuroendocrine tumor, this well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumor replaced the term carcinoid tumor. When we refer to this low-grade malignant neoplasm of the GI tract, which arise from the neuroendocrine cells, which is present in the submucosa, and that it occurs mainly in the adults and rarely seen in children. The peak incidence is seen in 6 to 7 decades of life. And it can arise from all the side of the organ. And concentrating on the GI tract, small intestine forms about 50% of the GI neuroendocrine tumor, in which among the small intestine, ileum is the most common site, after that followed by the jejunum and distal duodenum, in which 15 to 35% can also occur as a multiple lesion. In the neuroendocrine tumor, like I had said, can arise from any site. According to the embryological development, we can divide this neuroendocrine tumor according to foregut, midgut, and hindgut. And then also for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, according to the hormone secretion, you can divide into the different tumor. And if it arises from the unknown site, we are
Dr. Lal, little slowly. Yeah. Don't rush it. Slowly you can talk. Not to worry about the time. Maybe 5-10 minutes this way, that way is not done. Not to worry. Slowly you talk.
If it arises from the unknown origin, then we can say this unknown primary. Going to the clinical features, which will be stressing more on the intestine, jejunal ileal serotonin producing enterochromaffin cells neuroendocrine tumors mainly shows with the vague abdominal complaints, which may progress to the intestinal obstruction, which we are seeing in our cases. And then it is also can associated with nausea, vomiting, and also weight loss. Among these 5 to 10% of the cases shows the distal ileal tumors, which can associate it with liver metastasis. If there's a liver metastasis, this will increase the serotonin secretions, which will manifest as the carcinoid syndrome, showing characteristic features of diarrhea, flushing, intermittent hypertension, palpitation, and then fibrosis of the endocardium and right side heart valves. The macroscopic appearance, mostly the tumors are small in size. Even though they are small in size, they can be highly malignant, and then they can be metastasized even though it is small in size. So we should be specific with the size, and then according to the size, we can also see about that the percentage of metastasis, risk of percentage of metastasis. The mucosal, there can be a mucosal and submucosal nodules, which is mainly a yellow cut surface after formalin fixation due to the lipid deposits. And if there's an infiltration into the mesentery, this can occur in leads to the luminal narrowing, followed by the stricture formation and then obstruction. This is a macroscopic picture, the gross pictures, where we can see well circumscribed tumor, which is lying adjacent to the ileocecal valve, which is yellow cut surface. This is a multiple neuroendocrine tumor in the small intestine, showing a multiple sessile polyp. Here is the pictures where we can see a strictures. This is mainly due to the metastasized to the mesenteric lymph nodes. This is associated with the mesenteric fibrosis, leading to stricture and obstruction. Going to the histologic pictures, in the histology, the cells are mostly uniform round cells. These are mainly arranged in nest predominantly, and which will be followed by the trabecular and glandular pattern. If there is a glandular pattern, this can contain intraluminal mucin. And the nucleus are round with stippled chromatin, an indistinct nucleoli, and small amount of cytoplasm with a distinct cell border. If there's an infiltration through the muscularis propria, there can be a delicate cord structure can be seen. And then according to the this neuroendocrine tumor, this whether it's a gastrin-producing neuronal neuroendocrine tumor, there can be a predominantly arrangement of the trabecular and cord-like architecture. And if it is a somatostatin-producing neuroendocrine tumor, this will be predominantly of glandular and cribriform architecture. This we can have the hyperchromatic nuclei and pale eosinophilic cytoplasm, unlikely with other. Here is the microscopic pictures where we can see the neoplasm arranged in nest, trabecule and cords, and few acinar patterns, in which we can see the uniform round cells. With a moderate amount of pale eosinophilic cytoplasm, indistinct cell border, with a uniform nuclear membrane, showing a stippled chromatin, which we can also call this like a salt and pepper appearance. These neoplasms are separated by the fibrostroma. Grading is important, as this can have a prognostic significance in the stomach, duodenum, and pancreas, but very less prognostic significance for this duodenum, ileum, and large intestine. Grading can be divided into grade 1, grade 2, and sometimes grade 3 in different books. It is written as grade 3, or sometimes it's given as neuroendocrine carcinoma. In this grade 1, the mitotic in grading, it is mitotic figures, and Ki-67 is important. So if it is less than 2 mitotic figures per 10 high power field, and Ki-67 index is less than 2%, we can grade this as grade 1. And if the mitotic figures is 2 to 20% per 10 high power field, and Ki-67 3 to 20% will show the grade 2, this one neuroendocrine tumor. And then if it is more than 20 of the mitotic figures per 10 high power field, and if it is more than 20% of the Ki-67 index, then we can see it's grade 3 or neuroendocrine neoplasm. A carcinoma, sorry. In this tumor grading, mitotic figures can be seen. These mitotic figures will shows the actively dividing proliferative cell. This picture shows some of the pictures of the mitotic figures. And the Ki-67 index, like mentioned, that then 81, the percentage is less than 2. While less than two, and when in grade 2 is 2 to 20%, and in the grade 3 more than 20%, in which neuroendocrine tumor will shows lesser proliferation or lesser specific proliferation in the compared with the neuroendocrine carcinoma. In this classification, we can say it like this grade 1 or grade 2, also called as low and intermediate grade of neuroendocrine tumor are under well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumor. And this grade 3 or the high grade will be under poorly differentiated neuroendocrine tumor. And this grading is important for this determine the aggressiveness and the management plan. Seeing the histological features, how will we differentiate between the well-differentiated and poorly differentiated? In this well-differentiated, mostly the cells will be monomorphic population of small round cells, while in the poorly differentiated, there will be a cell dwarfism, more atypia. And then in the prognostics, prolonged survival in this well-differentiated, where there will be a poor prognosis on the poorly differentiated. Like mitotic figures and characteristic assessment, which we had already mentioned, and the necrosis will be absent in this well-differentiated, which we had not seen in our cases, and then necrosis is present in the poorly differentiated. When talking about the neuroendocrine tumor, this neuroendocrine neoplasm term shows talks about both the neuroendocrine tumor and neuroendocrine carcinoma. So this neuroendocrine tumor have grade 1, 2, and 3, which mostly they are neuroendocrine tumor are well differentiated, and then the poorly differentiated are neuroendocrine carcinoma, which will have grade 3. With that, we can also have this mixed neuroendocrine, non-neuroendocrine neoplasm, which can have this poorly differentiated or sometimes well differentiated also. This is microscopic pictures of the ileal neuro and well differentiated neuroendocrine tumor showing the organoid pattern, arranged nest, which the tumor is arising from the submucosa. This is a high pore where we can see a uniform population of round cells, a uniform population of round cells showing a moderate amount of cytoplasm, indistinct cell border, and then in stippled chromatin. This shows some fibrous, pre-marked fibrosis. And this picture shows the vascular invasion. And this picture shows this large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma, showing the poorly differentiated, and it can have this trabecular architecture. This argentiferin reaction can be seen in this argentiferin secreting granules. And this argyrophil stains is shown positive on the peptide-containing granules. Going to the differential diagnosis, this neuroendocrine tumor can be have three differential diagnoses: mixed carcinoid adenocarcinoma and adenocarcinoma and ganglioscytic paraganglioma. In this mixed carcinoid adenocarcinoma, the differentiating point which we should mainly see is there will be more infiltration comparatively in these cases compared with the neuroendocrine tumor. And then, like the name itself, we can see that this is a mixed histology, so there will be a mixed population of cells having a neuroendocrine cells showing a carcinoid tumor with the adenocarcinomatous tumor having more than 50% of the tumor. And this is a quite aggressive behavior compared with the neuroendocrine tumor. There is the picture where we can see both the population of the neuroendocrine cells and then the adenocarcinoma lesions of showing a glandular pattern. this can be mimicked by the serotonin-producing neuroendocrine tumor, as serotonin-producing neuroendocrine tumor can also present as a glandular, predominantly as a glandular architecture. So the differentiating features which we should see is the cytological atypia, more aggressiveness, and more pleomorphism. And then the tumor, adenocarcinoma tumor, should be more than 50%. In adeno, the different other differential, the differential diagnosis is adenocarcinoma. This will have like almost similar, but this will lack neuroendocrine differentiation compared with the previous one. And this will have more cytological atypia, more pleomorphism. And then invasive pattern will be glandular differentiation. Here showing some more the more atypia, more cytological atypia, showing pleomorphic and hyperchromatic nucleus, and then desmoplastic stroma, thick desmoplastic stroma. And the gangliocytic paraganglioma, which is one of the differential diagnoses, can have the triphasic cellular differentiation. Here we can see the some of the neuroendocrine cells. But the differentiating points is that there will be S1 cells, spindle S1 cells, and ganglion cells, which we not see in the neuroendocrine tumor. The take home message which we should remember is that, like I was said, that the tumor size is small mostly, and then it is mostly in the, especially in the intestine, it is mostly diagnosed late, especially they will come with an intestinal obstruction. These cases also, the patient was an on and off abdominal distension, which was cured again, and then again come with again, and later on the patient came with an obstruction. So this even though the size are small, there can be a high risk of metastasis. So according to the size, we can say the percentage of risk of metastasis. If it is less than one, there is a 22% of risk of metastasis. And if it is 1 to 2, if it is arising from the ileum, then it can be 50% of risk of metastasis. And 15% can have a risk of metastasis in the rectal portion. And if it is more than 2%, 2 centimeter, then 80% have a risk of metastasis. In our case, which is more than 2 centimeters, so it's a high risk of metastasis. And we should remember that all carcinoid or neuroendocrine tumor are potentially malignant. Previously, they are using the term carcinoid because it looks like it doesn't have malignant features. The cytoplasm and then the morphology are bland looking cytology, but they are having more malignant tendency, even though with the histological pictures. And then there can be an evidence, this clinical evidence of metastasis is best known to determine for the malignant potential. Other than these histological features are unreliable. And another one is that the invasion, whether it is a deep local mural penetration. If there's a deep local mural penetration, there can be a decreased survival. And with that presence of hepatic and nodal metastasis also, there can be a decreased survival rate. And overall, 5-year survival rate for small bowel carcinoid tumor is 90%. Even though it is highly metastasized, it can be highly metastasized. The tumor is slow-growing tumor, so there can be a high chance of survival rate for 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lal. It was a wonderful presentation. The presentation was very vast and extensive. That was good. So the case is open for discussion. I think only after doing K67, you will be able to determine Great. The malignant potential. Yes, and you have to do the metastatic workup also for this patient. So once the yes, pandemic situation settles down, you have to follow up the case. So if there are any yes, other questions, we can... If there are no more questions, we will have the certificates. I will share the certificates on the screen. So we congratulate all the participants. And this certificate is to Dr. Sangeeta from Vinayaka Mission. Certificate to Dr. Tamichelvi. Thank you, Dr. Tamichelvi, for active participation in all the meetings. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam.
Dr. Vijayalakshmi from Stanley Medical College. Congratulations, Dr. Vijayalakshmi. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Priyanka, thank you for your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Lal from Salem Medical College. Thank you, Dr. Lal. In spite of all the pandemic work and all that, I really congratulate and thank all the participants for actively participating in this. Dr. Karuna from JIPMER.
Thank you,
and ma'am. Dr. Nadia. So we will be sending the certificate to you and kindly accept it. So thanks for
joining us. Padma, yes, Dr. Tamesh Selvi and the PGs are still on the line?
Will all of them are there. All of them are there. Many of them are there. Some of them have left. Recent are there still.
Okay. Now, I just want to tell her, tell the forum that instead of BCC nowadays, the trichoblastic adenomas, even with pigmentation, poses a problem. The site of the tumor, duration of the tumor, and more of lobulation of the tumor islands in the dermal lesion without any takeoff from the epidermis as well as from the hair follicle rules out of BCC, though the peripheral palisading and other features will be there. And there is no markers for this. And one more thing is very slow growing, and history is more important. for the PGs. And nowadays, I myself stuck with many of these trichoblastic adenomas, and basal cell adenomas again poses a problem. Anyway, thank you for
thanks for the input, madam. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
So, once again, I thank everyone for your active participation, and see you all in TAPCon 2021 in June soon. So, we will be circulating the invitation, and kindly join us and make the event a grand success. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks to all the participants for joining us. Thank you. Shall we end up the meeting?